your grace for me will always be more than enough, more than enough. The power of Jesus Christ in me is more than enough, more than enough. Because my heart is full and my soul is free. In my weakness you had a plan for me, and I can't stop singing about your love. No, I can't stop singing about your love. Jesus, forever you will be more than enough. And I can't stop, no, I can't stop. Oh, 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 oh. You will provide, you will supply more than enough, more than enough. God, open heaven, open wide, more than enough, more than enough. Because my heart is full and my soul is free. In my weakness you had a plan for me, and I can't stop singing about your love. No, I can't stop singing about your love. Jesus, forever you will be more than enough. And I can't stop, no, I can't stop. Oh, 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 oh. So let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And I can't stop shouting, can't stop shouting. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. My soul is free. In my weakness you had a plan for me. Now I sing a song angels cannot sing. I have been reborn, I have been redeemed. And I can't stop singing about your love. No, I can't stop singing about your love. Jesus, forever you will be more than enough. And I can't about your love. No, I can't stop singing about your love. Jesus, forever you will be more than enough. And I can't stop, no, I can't stop. Oh, 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 oh.
Hey, Pastor Israel here. I'm one of the pastors at Trinity Church, and today I want to talk about the enemy's attacks on you, what they look like, and what you can do to stop them. Lord, I pray you would help us to understand your words and give us the wisdom, the boldness, the clarity to put them into practice in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, and God's people say amen. So one of the things as Christians that we forget from time to time is that we have a great enemy, the devil, whose sole focus is to make sure that he ruins or gets between your relationship with God. And his ultimate goal is to really drive you away from him completely, and he will stop at nothing until his goal is complete. Now, the shocking thing is that the devil is actually very good at what he does, and he has had much success in the lives of countless people throughout the generations, including yours. Now, we might think that something as severe as walking away from God is something that we would never do, right? I would never turn my back on God. But the truth is that if we're not careful, well, we might be the next person in line to fall and waver. I mean, we think about Peter. Peter was sure that he would never turn his back on Jesus. I will never forsake you. I will never turn my back on you. I will never deny you. And less than 24 hours later, Peter was denying Jesus 3 times, in fact. And so this is why we must be on high alert at all times for the devil's schemes. And that's what I want to talk to you about for tonight and next week. I want to talk to you about what the devil uses most against you to bring you down and what you can do to stop it. Now, speaking about Peter's first letter, he gives us this warning as he's wrapping up his letter in 1 Peter 5:8. He writes this, he says, "Stay alert, watch out, be vigilant, be on guard for your great enemy." Not just an enemy, but your great enemy, the devil. And then he says he prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. And the call to action there that Peter gives us is to stay alert, to watch out, to keep a close eye on the devil who's really out to destroy us. And so we need to make sure that we do all we can at all times, because the devil likes to attack us at all times. But the devil isn't just like a in-your-face type of enemy. Peter likens him to a lion, and if you have ever seen or studied the behavior of a lion, especially a lion who's out on the prowl, you know that they hide well and they blend into the surroundings, stalking their prey quietly, slowly, patiently, making their prey believe that no one is around, making their prey believe that they are in fact safe. And when the moment is right and the prey least sees it coming, well, the lion strikes and kills. Now, the devil works the exact same way, and that's why Peter had the wisdom to say, hey, he can be compared to a lion, because his most successful attacks, the devil's most successful attacks against us, against me, against you, are the ones we never see coming at times we least suspect it. And so tonight and next week, I want to shed some light on the most common and most successful ways the devil loves to attack your life. And I believe understanding how he works will help you understand how to better protect yourself and what to better watch out for, as Peter says. Now, the damage, and this is worth mentioning, that these tactics cause are far bigger than we know, because when the devil strikes, he strikes not to injure you, not to hurt you, not to hurt your feelings, to kill. John 10:10, Jesus said that the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. And then Peter, he said, no, this is like a lion looking for someone to devour. So it's absolutely worth paying attention to the devil's tactics on your life so that we can know how to better guard our lives against these fatal strikes and attacks. I like to call them the devil's dirty deeds, two of which are, number one, distraction, which attacks the mind, and it's really attacking vision and direction. And the second is attacking, I call it discouragement. He attacks the heart, the passion, your abilities. Now, what makes these two weapons so powerful is that he doesn't have to destroy you. All he has to do is distract you, and he doesn't have to destroy you and jump in your face. He just has to discourage you, and eventually you'll do the rest. You'll give up on your own. And these two are amongst his favorite to use against us, because again, distraction attacks our vision, our mission, and discouragement attacks our passion and purpose. And a person with no clear mission or vision won't really go anywhere, and a person with no passion or purpose won't really do anything. And this is why, again, the devil will come at us with distraction and discouragement. Tonight, let's focus on distraction. Now, what makes distraction so fatal and so effective is that we don't know we've been distracted. Think about this. We don't know we've been distracted until after we've been distracted. Think about the times you had a goal in mind or you were set to do something, maybe even just common and practical, but you got sidetracked, you got distracted. Next thing you know, you were focused on something completely different than you originally intended. And when we're distracted, we're not focusing on what we set out to do, which is our mission and our vision. And as long as the devil has you distracted, you won't focus on what truly matters. Think about the times you decided to dedicate yourself to growing in God. And so you said, I'm gonna spend more time praying. I'm gonna spend more time reading his word, because I know I need to. And we know all this stuff. And so you said, I'm just gonna start doing it. But then you were distracted by something else and you never got around to doing it. And the devil didn't need to get in your face in those times. He simply needed to distract you with a TV show or a series, a to-do list, or maybe something else that got your attention. I mean, take the example of Mary and Martha, if you will, for this. We're told in Luke 10 that they host a dinner party for Jesus at their house. And Luke 10 verse 39 says that Martha had a sister named Mary, but she sat at the Lord's feet listening to Jesus's message. And verse 40 says, but Martha was distracted by all the preparations to be made. Now Martha goes to Jesus complaining about Mary, thinking that Jesus is gonna take her side. Hey Jesus, Mary is over here listening to you. She should be helping me. I mean, come on, get her to help. But to her surprise, Jesus tells her, Martha, few things are needed, or indeed, he says, only one. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. And as long as we're distracted, understand this, we're not focusing on what truly matters. This is why Proverbs tells us in Proverbs 4, verse 25 and through 27, it says, look straight ahead and fix your eyes on what lies before you. It says, mark out a straight path for your feet, stay on the safe path. And watch this, it says, don't get sidetracked. Don't get distracted. Don't get pulled away. Keep your feet from following evil. Now consider this. I think it's important to ask, as we're talking about distractions, where does the devil have you distracted? Now you might think, well, I don't think he has me distracted. But remember that his weapon of distraction is so powerful and effective because we won't realize we've been distracted until after we've been distracted. And so again, I ask you, where does the devil think about it? What is the devil potentially using around you to keep you distracted? Look closely and really ask yourself, what has sidetracked me? What did I commit to doing for God or to better my relationship with God? Maybe you committed yourself to waking up early in the morning and praying, or maybe praying at night, or maybe setting a really good time to study God's word, or just really sow into yourself. Maybe that is what you set out to do, just grow as a person, but you stopped. You never got around to it because something else came along. Sometimes distractions can be a job. They come in the form of a job. Oh, I'm gonna get this temporary job. I'm not gonna be able to go to church, or I'm not gonna be able to go to Bible study, or I'm not gonna be able to go to life group. But as soon as my schedule settles, I'll go back to the things of God, and that's a distraction. Sometimes a distraction can be a relationship. Sometimes it can be all of the things that we want to keep our kids busy with. Well, they need to take karate, and they need to take football, and they need to take basketball, and they need to take ballet, and we are the ones that add to this list of distractions. Sometimes it could just be time wasters like TV or social media. But what is it? What has pulled you away from focusing on your relationship with God? Think about that, because that might be a distraction that the devil has sent to keep you away from focusing on what truly matters. Ask God in your prayer time. I really challenge you. Say, Lord, show me if I have been distracted and what I have been distracted with. What has gotten in the way of me connecting with you more? And pray, as Proverbs says, pray that God would help you look straight ahead, to fix your eyes on what lies before you and not get sidetracked and not keep your feet from following evil. Because listen, that is what the devil wants to distract you with. He wants to, number one, pull you away so you don't focus on what matters, which is your relationship with God. Secondary are parenting and marriage and all the other things that matter in your life. Thirdly, are you becoming the person that God said for you to become, the purpose you have in your life? And He wants to pull you away from those things and have you entertain yourself with insignificant things that in the end don't really add value to your relationship with God. So that's all for tonight. I want to pray, and I really challenge you to ask God, where have I been distracted? What am I distracted with? And Lord, help me to wake up and fix my eyes on what lies before me. Or as the writer in Hebrews says, to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Lord, I pray for all my brothers and sisters watching. If we have been distracted, if we have fallen into one of the attacks that the devil loves to use on us, Lord, help us to see right through it. Help us, Lord, to wake up. Help us to realize, Lord, if we have decided to focus on something else instead of what truly matters, so that like Mary, we can find what truly matters, and that is our relationship with you. Help my brother, my sister, to understand, see these things, Lord, and do something about it. All of this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite you to join us next week as we look at the second thing that He likes to use, which is discouragement in our lives and what we can do about it. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next week.